Hello. Hello, everybody. Welcome. Can you all hear me?
Sure.
Your head?
Yes, hello.
Okay, that's good. Okay. It's already getting a habit doing online sessions. For today, I would like to discuss a few of the new features that we have added to XSharp. Not all of them are new in the sense of being added in the last build, but at least they are new compared to what you had in Visual Object. By the way, what you see behind me is a Hubble picture to celebrate the 30th anniversary of the Hubble telescope. And I remember doing a session in a German conference showing old technology. There was a rocket. Now we have an old telescope who is still 30 years old and producing beautiful pictures. So for me, that's proof that not only new things are useful, but old things should not be thrown away. And I think the X-based language is an example of such an old thing, which is still very useful nowadays. Okay, I will show my desktop mostly during the session, so you guys can see some PowerPoint and some code. I'll have to switch screens every now and then. This is the second time I'm doing a Zoom session for an audience like this, so please give me, it is possible that things will not work, but I'll do my best. Okay, you should be seeing the PowerPoint again. And what I wanted to discuss today, I'm not sure if we can make it to the end in the all of the time, but some language constructs like the is keyword and where you use it, our parameters for each, which we now also support on the array type, switch statement, and so on and so on. I will upload the PowerPoint and the samples after the session, so in case I don't go make it to the end, you at least have an idea of what I was planning to speak about. Okay. Is or is instance of? Many of you have used VO and have seen this kind of code. The VO SDK is full of is instance ofs. And I guess that's because some of the things we need in the language were not available in Visual Objects. So that's why they have this construct. I've taken here an example from the control class where, depending on what the parent is, the control class wants to do something. And if the parent is a data window or a dialog window, it wants to send a parent a control focus change. And if it's an underscore form window, whatever that may be, it's going to set a last focus. Now, what is instance of? It's a way to check your parent class. It's slow. If you want, we can look at what it does. And there's a potential problem. Is instance of uses a symbol to check for a type. And of course, since it's a symbol, you could type anything. And I found when I was looking at VO SDK a couple of situations where the author typed underscore WND app, but the real type name is WIND app. So there was an I missing. The compiler doesn't complain because it's not there. And in the end, the application is probably not doing what you want it to do. Now let's go to some sample code. Switch to another screen. Can you see my source code now?
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. Good. I have already put some code in here that I don't want to show yet. I'll show that later. Get rid of this. This is a Visual Objects kind of code, and this emulates things that we see in the VO SDK. So we have an array of things. In the VO SDK, it could be an array of controls on the window, The code in a method or a function checks if it's a particular kind, then it wants to do something. Now in this case, the getSumArray returns a couple of objects. These are stupid objects, but just to show you what they can do. And the Pluto object returns woof, Felix returns meow, Obi-Wan, well, you can read it, I will see it later. In this particular example, I'm going to check for six different types. I'm going to see, display the element, the type, and I'm going to call the speak to me method. And if it's none of the one of these, then it says I don't speak, because we assume that no other class knows how to speak. I've put a try catch around it, and let's see if this builds and runs. So this is the traditional visual object style of code. It fails because, now it says, oh element speak to me doesn't work. And why is that? Because oh element is a class object. And we need to tell the compiler that we want late binding. So I'm not sure if this is properly readable, but I'm setting the allow late binding property to true, which is what visual objects always does. So I'm going to compile again with late binding, and now it compiles. So let's run this code. I've incremented the size of the screen, and now we see another problem. That's why I have a try catch. I've made a typo in the method name. The class Pluto doesn't have an exported method speak to me. And let's see, is it true? Yeah, it's not speak to me, it's speak. Okay. So what I wanted to do is to call the speak. Again, you see here, I've got a question this week from people saying, what is the difference between early bound and late bound? Now, in early bound code, the compiler would have told me there is no speak method or speak to me. In late bound code, it assumes that we know what we're doing. And after debugging and testing, we usually do know what we're doing, but the first effort usually is an exception, like this one. So let's try it again. And now we see, is this font under the console window readable, or should I enlarge it a bit more?
It looks fine, Robbie.
This is...
No, Robert, it's already big enough, even for my screen.
My headphone is not working. Doesn't work. So what do we see here is that the Pluto, Wolf, Meow, etc. worked, but the last element doesn't speak. That's strange. So why is that? That's because I did an is instance of Arthur, and this is to emulate what was in the VO SDK. Actually, the class is not called Arthur, the class is called Arthur Dent. But since we use is instance of, there's no compile time checking. Now, the better way to do this is to use the is construct. The is construct will actually at compile time insert code and will check if the class exists, etc. And will, in this case, will tell me that there is no type or namespace Arthur. Let's increase this font. As you can see, the type or namespace Arthur could not be found. And that's because the real type is Arthur Dent. So if I change that to Arthur Dent, now the compiler actually recognized that I didn't make a typo. This is how I detected in the VO SDK that there was a misspelled class name, WND app, because there is no class W in the app. And actually, it was not one, it was in several cases. So now I do it again, and now they all make their sound. So now we have six elements, and we use the is. Is this the best way to do it? No, actually not, because we're still having to spell out all the different class names that implement or that have this particular speak method. And we do not have any compile time checking. So what is the better way to do it? This is something that probably the original authors of VO would have done as well, but they didn't have support for interfaces. That's in .NET to specify an interface, something that all these types have in common. Now I have prepared an interface I speak. Where is it? Over here. So I have an interface I speak that says there's a method called speak that is void, so it has no return type, and it does something. So what I can do here is change this to say, if the object is an I speak, then I will call it. This is much cleaner. And you see that it speaks, but again, we have an exception. Arterdent doesn't speak. Now, why is that? Because Arterdent, as you can see, forgot to implement the iSpeak interface. If I implement the interface on Arterdent, now it actually works. So what has happened? I've changed this instance of to is, and I'm checking not for an exact type now, but I'm checking for an interface. And this is the recommended way to do it. So you declare an interface with whatever you want to do. Now, this is still not optimal because I'm calling the speak method on an object of type object. And this is not early bound. So that means that the compiler will still have to produce a late bound call. And let me show that to you. I'm going to set a breakpoint in Pluto and run this in a debugger. Now, in the call stack, let me tell you something what I've done. I've enabled in Visual Studio, disabled the option enable just by code. If you enable that, in this case, it doesn't really make a difference because I have a debug version of the runtime. What you will see here is that access start, line 19, actually calls an internal send in this with some helper method. It finally calls wolf in the Pluto class. So there's a whole lot of steps in between here. These particular methods are using what's called reflection to query a type for its methods. And if the method is found, it queries what kind of parameters it wants and actually calls the method using reflection. This is not optimal, but it works. That's most of the VO SDK used to work like this. So that's why we support it. But the best way to do it would be this. Is now declare a local and do something like this. And then call the speak method on the element, on the interface. The object here is actually something that implement that has an iSeek interface. The code still runs, but let's set a breakpoint again over here. And now we see that from the start method to Pluto speak, there's nothing in between. This is a direct call. So this is the fast way to call this method. We still have different classes and different class hierarchies. We have Pluto and we have Felix and we have Spock, but they all implement speak, and the compiler can produce optimal code to actually call this particular method. Now the final thing I want to show, because this is a bit of, I think, annoying. It's some code that you actually don't want to do. We already specified that we have an O element and an I speak, and it would be nice if you could, in the same line, get the speak interface. And the syntax for that has been added in one of the last builds, and it's var O speak. This var O speak declares a variable, that's why it says var. It's a variable with an implied type, and the type is implied by the I speak in front of it. And the O speak also is now has a visibility of just this particular if statement. So it's outside, it's not visible. This compiles. But if you do something like this, compiler will say, I don't know the particular, as you see, OSpeak doesn't exist in the current context. So the speak only exists in the context of this if statement, which also means that if you would write a few lines of extra code and you go below, you could do the same construct again and again have a new instance of the variable OSpeak. So this still works. Let me see. Yeah. You see my PowerPoint again? Okay. So what we have is some value is type name. That's what we have, and we can change it. And we change it to a common interface in this case. And the new additional syntax is now that we can specify var and a new variable name. This is fast. It is a single IO instruction. There's no extra runtime code involved to do a late bound call. So this actually works. There's actually only one place where you still would want to use is instance of. And that is if you're using dynamic loading of assemblies. Some of the customers do that. And then at compile time, the class could not be available. And in that case, is instance of would work. But I would still recommend to let this external class then implement an interface and use the is construct on the interface. That's a bit how dependency injection works. So you have a interface, it says we're going to dynamically load something that implements a particular interface. You create this object one way or the other, and then because you know the interface, you know how to call it, but you have no physical dependency on the external DLL. Okay, this is what I wanted to tell you about is. Is this clear so far? Any questions? I don't see chat window, let me see.
Does it work with case, switch case statement?
You mean switch type of something, case type one, case type two?
Yeah.
No, at this moment not. I know it does in C sharp. It requires something that we still haven't implemented in the X sharp switch statement. Actually, it is something on a to-do list, and Nikos is working on these kind of things. And you could compare it to when clauses on exceptions. It's the same kind of language construct that has to sit behind that. Okay, good. The second thing I want to briefly discuss is out parameters. Let me bring up a sample in the same time. Okay, many .NET methods contain out parameters, like, for example, int32 try parse. It takes a string and it returns a result. To use these in the past, you have to declare a variable in advance and pass it with out. We now have added two new syntaxes. You can say int32 try parse out var I result, or you can do int32 try parse out I result as type. Some people would prefer the out I result as int in this case, because it's clearly declares that it's an integer. On the other hand, other people would argue that int32 as a type name already implies that the return value will be an int32. That's a question of taste. Let me show you an example. Okay, here I have a sample where in a do-while loop or a repeat until loop, I'm going to ask to enter a number, and then I'm going to try parse it, and I've declared iResult here ahead of time, and I'm going to get the integer and show its value. Come on, heck. Enter a number, 1, 2, 3, is a valid number. Of course, that's valid. It's not a valid integer, and let's do something that's very big. It's also not a valid integer. Okay, so this uses the old style of out. Now, what I can do now is get rid of the declaration and do it like this. So this works, or this works as well. Now, this is nice. Sometimes you just want to see if you can actually parse the number, but you're not interested in the return value. And we have introduced something that is also available in C#, what's called a discard. What you can do is this: you declare a variable with the name, just the name underscore. And since we don't actually want to get a value, this is a value that actually the compiler will generate a variable, but because of the name, it knows that we're not actually interested in the value, so it will not tell us that we're not using the variable. And this compiles as well. So it actually declares a variable that can be discarded. And this is an interesting syntax because it tells you things. Now, I know that one of the members of the dev team, who's also online now, didn't like this and it said, I suggest we use this syntax. Now, well, the nice thing about our parser is that we actually support both now. So you can either type var underscore or null in the out parameter, and both will actually indicate that you use a discard variable name and that we're not interested in the variable. We just want to get the return value of int32 try parse. Big difference between out and ref, I didn't mention it at the beginning, is that out doesn't require you to actually initialize the variable. Well, if you would have done ref, then you actually have to set an initial value because we do not know what int32 try parse is going to do. And ref says, I'm going to give it a value, I'm going to get a value back. And then the compiler will say, okay, you have to, in advance, give us a value. Okay. Let me switch to the other screen. You guys see the PowerPoint? I hope so. The discard variable name, we will use on other places as well, and we will follow the same pattern as C#. We are adding tuple support. Tuple was mentioned on the website this week, and I have a example here of how it could look like. We haven't decided on the final syntax yet, but something like this: a function son of Sarek, which returns two strings. So this is going to be a tuple, a value, it's a value type, it contains two strings. And it could be the name and the planet, Spock and Vulcan. And the possible way we're going to do this is something like this: variable person, comma, planet equals son of Sarek. This will actually declare two variables that are returned as a value type tuple from the function son of Sarek, and we get both values, so we can display both person and planet. Now, if we want to discard falcon, pun intended, you could pass the underscore, so the discard variable says, oh, we know it returns two values, but I'm only interested in planet. And again, in this case, the compiler would not tell us if we're assigning something to planet that we're not using. Because we specify a discard variable name there, the variable will be ignored, basically. This is work in progress. We may change the syntax, we're not sure yet. But very likely something like this. A big difference is that is you could also use something like construct like return a class from a function, but that's something that's a reference type. It will be in the heap, and this is returning a value type on the stack, so it's actually a bit more efficient. Also means that if you assign one of those tuples to another, it actually duplicates the strings, and it doesn't pass the reference to those strings. Okay, let's go. I'm not sure why I changed the order, but let's go to the for each statement. Something new in the language compared to visual objects is the for each statement. And it's a mechanism to enumerate the collection, list, array, etc. You declare a for each iterator variable in the for each statement, either in the syntax name as type or in the syntax var name. If you specify var name, then the compiler will determine the type. And if you enumerate an X-based array, so what the array keyword, that is a list of usuals. So if you use var there, then the compiler says, okay, this is a list of usuals. So you do not know the type, and you have to be specific in those cases. Yeah, there was a question. Okay. For each is the recommended replacement for the runtime function asend. If you look in the VO SDK, you will see something like, oh, sorry, asend a column scatter, which actually, again, generates late bound code. So it's going to evaluate a column, so it gets every element of a column and then calls the send method with the scatter symbol. And this is actually going to use reflection to see, does this type have a scatter method? And indeed, if it has, it calls the scatter method. This should be written in .NET. At least I think it's a better way. This code comes from the data browser code. It's something like, for each O column as data column in a column, O column scatter. It, first of all, it declares the type. And that's also the compiler now can directly call our column scatter. And I think this is better readable. I think I have an example of this too. Yeah. Okay. I will go to the example. We'll switch screens again. I have an example here of a for each. Now I'm for eaching the name. I'm making an error. I want to go back to the first one. Because for here, you can see that we actually wrote an enumerator. Now, if we know that if the array contains I speak elements, I can do things like this. And get rid of the counter and of the O element. Now I think this is an example of much cleaner code than before. No, we can error. Why is that? Okay, and now I have O element is already of the right type. And as you see, this works. What is important is that the actual elements have to implement the type. Remember before that Arthur Dent didn't have the interface. If you do that, we get an invalid cast exception, because at runtime, we detect now we're not asking with an if statement, we're actually casting it, and casting it to the type that doesn't implement. This type cannot be casted to I speak because it doesn't implement it. So that is a difference. The as I speak here is not a check for I speak, but it says I know that this interface is implemented for each element. So it doesn't filter what you, if you wanted to filter, you could have done this. And then in inside here, if all element is I speak, and now the last one isn't shown as you would expect. So the for each here is a useful addition, I think, because it is actually, if you use it, you can get rid of counters, etc. If you need the counter because you want to get the position in the array, then you're better off using the old for next syntax. But if you don't need the counter, do it. Also, if you want to manipulate the array A values and you're going to, let's say, delete elements from it, don't use for each, because you may end up having a problem, because well, you could reach the end of the array before you know it. And but that was also the problem when you did the end count equals aln, and then if you change the length of the array in the loop, it would also not properly work. If you want to be safe there and you have system link like here, you can always do something like this in .NET. No, you can't. I'm not sure why, but normal for I lists, etc., where you can use two array and that would create a copy basically. For now, this is, I think, okay. Good. Let's go back to the next sample, because that's what I wanted to show, and the switch statement. Good. Something new we've added, and for the people coming from Foxpro, this is also new. It's switch case, and it's what we call a do case replacement. Do you see it? No. Over here. It's a do case replacement. In the do case, every case branch has an expression that has to return a true or false. The switch, so each case branch gets evaluated from top to bottom. And if you have 30 case branches in a do case, by the time you get to the 30th, 29 other case expressions have been evaluated. That's sometimes useful, sometimes not. If you introduce switch case, that's the case that C# or C++ has as well. And it is different because the expression is only evaluated once, and the elements in the case branch are literals. So let's have a look at my sample code. Here is sample code, and we have something that Fabrice in the past created, a list of strings. By the way, did you know that you can initialize a collection like this? At least at the moment, you can for a single dimensional collection. So you create the objects. These curlies create a list of strings, and then between two curlies, you pass it a list of values. And this is the same as doing my list as Chris, my list as Fabrice, etc. So this is an initialization of the collection in one line. C# would do something like new string and then curlies. Now we replace new string with string with brackets curly curly, And then this is the initializer. So this function returns a list of names. And now over here, we see a switch statement. The switch statement evaluates name to lower. This is the expression that gets evaluated once. And then it's going to jump to the cases that it matches. Now, there is the difference with our switch statement and C++ or C sharp is we do not need force you to use the break statement. So we assume when there's statements between two cases that there have to be automatically a break statement inserted. I think this is cleaner. If we have two case labels without break or statements in between, they belong to each other. So these two will both evaluate to the same block of code. And we have otherwise, that if you add someone else to the list as a value that's not there, it will automatically go to the otherwise. Now let's see if this works. I'm sure it works, but it's always good to show it. Go to the fonts again. As you can see, Chris is from Greece, Fabrice from France, Nicholas from Greece, Robert from the Netherlands. Now, I know I saw a name here on the list who says, who used this already from day one in Visual, in X-Sharp. It says, this helped me to find code where I had accidentally two case statements with the same value. It was very easy to do in Visual Objects and also in FoxRow, I assume, because you copy things and you forgot to change things. Now, if you compile this, the compiler is going to tell me, well, much clearer than this, again, this is the previous one, but this one, the switch statement contains multiple cases with the label value Robert. Now, much easier than this is one case. So if you do something stupid, you copy code, but you forget to change things, this is going to be a lifesaver. So it actually makes sure that you have unique cases there. I already know what the expected question is. If you've seen C Sharp, they have something like that, like this. Case when we don't support it yet. It's also something on our list to do that. And also there was the question before, if you can use something else than literals, no, that won't work. And also, if you would try something like this, that won't work either. The reason for this is you could say that Fabrice here is a literal, but there is no .NET type for symbol. So we are actually implementing symbol as a structure, and this is not really a literal. Maybe with a lot of work, we could probably do this by casting it to a number, et cetera, et cetera. But you should just didn't do it because it's probably not worth the effort. And if you want to do something with symbols, realize that symbols are in .NET are just as fast as strings, basically, if you make them, like in this case, all lower or all uppercase. There's really no big performance benefit in using symbols. That's also why if you look at the built-in code in our runtime, some of the methods that in the past used to accept a symbol now accept a string. We automatically convert strings to symbols or back. There's implicit conversions in the runtime, so you can mix them basically. Good. Now, I'm going to do something very quick in between, and that is we have a new notation for literal numbers. I'm going to insert it in my sample as well. Have you ever seen a large number like the first on the second bullet? It's impossible to read, basically. So how big is it? Well, I now try to read the one with the underscores, and you will see the difference. We allow you to put underscores in numbers to separate groups. There's no compile time checks for the meaningfulness of numbers. So if you do, like in the last one, you put the underscores and have one zero in between or two zeros, we don't care. We just ignore them and we build the number based on all the numeric values in the list. But at least I think the one where I think it's 10 billion is much easier to read than the one in the first line. So, and the compiler just accepts it. So let's go back to the source. Just demo it. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 3, 3. This actually works. And now let's see. I have in the habit of doing it in the reverse order, so I know I put them on the right spots. And as you see, it still works. So this proves that you can make your code readable with underscores without sacrificing anything else. I would definitely recommend that. And it's not just for integral numbers, you can also do it for floating point numbers. And of course, now it has taken, let's do it like this. As you can see, it actually throws them away and the value is correct. This particular example is running in the core dialect. That's why the number actually shows the way you expect it. If I would switch this to Visual Objects or FoxPro, then I would have to add our runtime DLL. Then you would see that a large number like this is not displayed properly. That has to do with the number formatting that is enforced historically by Visual Objects and DBase. But in core, this works. This is just something quick in between. If you want to see what dialect is used, you can insert a compiler macro like this. And you can actually see that this compiles in X-Sharp core. Okay. This was a quickie. I think we have to finish. It's 4:45. One more sample. And that is, I know some of the experienced Vulkan users have asked for it, and C-sharp users, is support for pragmas. This is added in one of the recent builds. And pragmas actually allow you to enable disable warnings or enable disable compiler options in code. So you can actually override what was specified from the property project property dialect in Visual Studio. So, for example, if you enable list late binding, you can switch that off or vice versa. If you don't enable it, but you know that one file you have to use late binding, can use the pragma options to actually override that as specified. For warnings, we support two syntaxes. You may wonder why, but that's historical. We support the C-sharp syntax for people who are used to C-sharp, pragma warnings, disable 1, 2, 3, 4. You can also use the XS in the front, so you can also give it a string. You can use disable, you can use restore, which means that it's set it back to the command line parameter. And the number is optional. So you can also do pragma warning disable, which disables all warnings, and pragma warning restore, which restores all warnings to how they were set in the project properties. And the Vulkan.net syntax is pragma warnings, and then between parentheses, the number and the keyword off, on, or default. So I think this is useful if you have code that, for example, we have in the command line option, AZ, that tells if arrays should be 0 or 1 based. Now, I know for business code, it's always useful to use 1 based because that's what humans understand. But the computer likes 0 based. Now, what we do is we subtract 1 to make sure that if you do element 1, we actually ask the .NET runtime to give us element 0. Now, that subtraction has a little bit of overhead. So if you know that you have code that is performance critical, you may want to write that particular piece of code with zero-based arrays. Now, in that case, you could insert the pragma options AZ on and then say, okay, this code, this file has zero-based arrays. I know what I'm doing. And even if this file is part of a project where everything else is one-based, this file is zero-based. I think it's useful. I've used it myself on quite some spots because you want to, for example, get rid of late binding in your app, but you know one or two files are still a bit of a pain. You can set the property on your project to disable late binding, but on the one or two source files, you enable it. There's two things to remember. Actually, it's one thing, basically. You cannot do it in the body of a method. Pragma statements have to come between entities that has between methods or accesses and assigns or properties or functions or procedures. As soon as you put a pragma options or a pragma warnings in a function, it's going to assume that that function is finished. And you're going to get strange warnings. And to show you that, let's go back to the source, because this is a common error, common reason for problems. Let's say for some stupid reason I want to do pragma warnings using the Vulkan.net syntax, and then over here I want to set it to default. Now if I compile this, I get function build list, not all code paths return a value. And the variable my list is declared but never used. And that is because the compiler thinks that this particular function has ended on this line. So it says, okay, I expect a return statement, but there's no return statement before the line. And my list is not used before the line. So this particular pragma warnings is actually the end of an entity. Now, if I move it in front of this and behind of this one, it actually works. And now I have something else. Okay. Did I do something stupid? I should have prepared this then, but we see a problem here.
You have your hyphens on the 33rd line.
Sorry?
There are hyphens on the 33rd line. Minus, minus, minus.
Thank you. That's great. Now it works. It's always good when someone is, because you do something to make things clear and then you kill your own code. So now, what it does, what it happens is whenever we detect something now, in this case, let's see if I, now it has a 165, it says unassigned local, so I can disable 165. I have no error anymore because, but now of course, I have a variable that's not initialized. So, but if I wanted to get rid of the error, or suppress the warning in this case, you can do it. But of course, suppressing warnings also means that you know what you're doing. And my experience is not everybody always knows what he's doing. So best is not to disable the warnings and let the code just run as you expect. Okay. Yeah, I'm not sure, we're running out of time. So I want to quit for now. What I wanted to mention, just in the PowerPoint, and then you can download the samples if you want. We support now untyped variables by reference. See example, but well, I'm not going to show the sample. This is something we introduced in one of the latest builds, and we actually had to jump through some hoops because this was not easy. since the way how we are passing variables that are not typed to as parameters, we actually construct an array. But we did, the compiler now actually generates code and it detects this, then it will get the values back from this array and assign them back to the locals. It really works well. It's not enough time now to show. Something else that we added in build 2.4, and this is also something that some people have asked for, if you had native resources in your app, like VO forms with a resource behind it or a VO menu, you would not get any version information in your EXE or DLL unless you added the version info resource. So even if you set the assembly attributes, assembly file version and etc., that would not be used. What a compiler does now is says, okay, if you have these assembly versions, and you have unmanaged native resources, we will generate a version resource and merge it with the native resources that you supply in your file. So your file will have a native resource which is based on the assembly info properties. So that actually helps to have all your assemblies use the same mechanism for setting version numbers, descriptions, etc. We use it ourselves. Before 2.4, we had to have a resource in the GUI classes assembly, but now we don't have that anymore. The version number in the assembly is based on the assembly level attributes. I think it's nice. And we thought about it a lot, and it happened to be easier than expected. Okay, that's what I have prepared for today. I hope there was something interesting in there for everybody. Let's stop the share. We still have how many? 17 people on board. So most of you didn't run away. Thank you for being so polite. We're going to record this, and we're going to save this recording on YouTube, so people who missed it because they're in Australia in another time zone will also be able to look at that. I see Chris is sharing links to the source. Thank you, Chris, for monitoring this from a distance. I will stop for now.